rock and roll. The crowd seems to love this.
Careful, it's slippery. I had it wet.
Exclusively on Tucson's new run, 92.1 KFMA, Green Valley, Tucson, 292 CM, Summer Haven.
Loveline is meant for an adult audience. Loveline may contain sexually oriented content. Listener discretion advised.
Now, here's Loveline.
1-800-LOVE-191.
With Dr. Drew and Adam Carolla.
Hey, Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Fax number 310-854-4455. Dr. Drew's board certified physician, Dixon medicine specialist. Tonight, our guests from the Los Angeles Kings are Rob Blake and Sean O'Donnell. And remember, Drew, last night when I was giving my speech about hockey players getting a lot of chicks because they were not abnormally large guys,
right?
Sort of regular sized guys.
Right.
I was wrong.
Yeah.
These guys are mountains.
Yeah. Remember the guy we met from the, what's it, Chicago?
Yeah.
He was not a small man.
No. No, but I thought hockey players used to go, like, you know, 5'11", 6', and 190 pounds. I mean, isn't it just been in the last few years that they turned into a behemoth?
Yeah, I think guys have gotten a lot bigger the last couple of years. I think the average size now is probably 6'1", and about 2205. So, yeah, they've gotten a little bit bigger the last couple of years.
And, I mean, you guys are, 6'3", and 6'4"? And with skates, or as Drew likes to call them, heels. But I would never call them heels in front of you guys. But with the skates on, you're going at 6'8", 6'9", right?
Yeah, it's like what he said. The guy's gotten a lot bigger in the past probably 10 years. You know, you see the young kids getting drafted, they're all 6'4", 6'5", or up.
But is it, you know, there's certain sports that are going to go a certain direction because that's just where the future of the game is. For instance, basketball, the hoop's 10 feet, so everyone's going to keep inching closer to the hoop, like ivy growing towards something. But hockey, the puck's on the ground. So being 8 feet, for instance, might not be an advantage, although you get to knock guys down.
Yeah, well, I think the thing is the guys are getting bigger, but they're getting quicker and stronger. So, you know, the bigger you are, the more powerful you are, you're going to overpower the little guys. And it seems to be going that way. The trend
it's
is...
It's like every sport.
Yeah, the bigger guys when they're young, and you can mold them into a player.
I like sports, and I've always watched hockey, but I have not... Growing up in North Hollywood, we didn't have hockey. I mean, I remember the first time I traveled to, like, Utah, and they were telling me about the hockey team, the high school hockey team, and I was like, that was bizarre that guys in high school had an ice rink at their high school and played. I mean, there's no guys from the Valley that play hockey, do they?
No, there's not too many from the Southwest. Most of the guys are Canadian or from, Europe or Russia.
Right.
Or, maybe like the Northeast part, the Michigans and,
You got to grow up with it because of the skating and because
Pretty
of the difficulty.
Much. Pretty much. In Canada, the minute you can walk, your parents basically throw some skates or heels on you and just push you out on the ice and away you go. So there's not a whole lot of ice down here, but it is growing.
Yeah, but and I guess as the sport grows, you'll start getting different people from different places into it.
Crazy. My daughter ice skates 8 hours a week.
Really?
We can't get her off the ice. It's bizarre. It's not something we're into. She just got onto it and she can't get her off.
Like, kids go a little nutty with the skating when they're younger, but they usually get off it eventually. And it's usually when the parents get tired of driving them to the rink.
It's something they get into. You just can't stop it.
In like the East and in Canada, dads will spray down the backyard. Yeah. They'll just flood the basement or something. I can't imagine that. Did they do that?
I mean, a lot of places in Canada or like I said, in the Northeast, your pool is they freeze it in the wintertime and throw your kids out there, and that's what they do for 4 hours, as opposed to down here, they'll, dribble a basketball or play wiffle ball or whatever it is.
Go surfing.
Wiffle ball. We're not all pussies here. Wiffle ball. I played a little high school football. Drew played 7.5-man football at his prep school. Do they have a hockey team, or was it just like squash or lacrosse or something you guys
didn't even
played?
Have that.
Oh, man. And so there's a few questions I always have for hockey players or suggestions. One is, I can't believe they just decided to wear helmets the last couple of years. When I see films of those guys in the 50s, 60s, even into the 70s and early 80s, skating around. Actually, my favorite period in hockey is around the late 60s when the guy had the big handful of pomade in the hair and they had that long, slick back hair and they'd go flying down the ice. But Drew, when you see this old hockey footage with guys with the shoulder pads, and they got all the pads and the skates and everything, but no helmet.
And no teeth.
But it doesn't it look like someone pulled their helmet off, like they're missing something?
Right, right.
Why did it take them so long to figure the helmet thing out? It's ice, it's a puck, it's sticks, it's mean guys. Isn't that the first piece of equipment you should put on?
It should be, but I think, you know, as the games change, I mean, guys just didn't wear helmets. So, you know, if you put one on, you're probably considered
a sissy.
Yeah, basically. So
right.
You just didn't wear it. And then until a couple of big-name players or bigger stars and put one on, or there's some serious injuries, guys started to wear it. But definitely now it's mandatory. You have to have the helmet.
I know before, talking to some of the guys that played back then, too, now you get sticks up in the face, but back when they didn't have helmets and someone brought their stick up above the waist or above the shoulders, your own team got mad at you. I mean, there was just a respect
right.
for, you know, for your face and for your teeth. They, you know, if someone did something, like I said, your own guys would, you know, give you a smack and say, keep your stick down.
Drew, can you keep the outside reading material away from the microphone while conducting the goddamn interview, please? You realize how bad that sounds? Have you leafing through mail while I'm trying to talk to the hockey guys? Well, I think it's like any sport in that as the equipment gets better, the game gets better. It's like football. The kind of hitting that goes on in football now just couldn't have existed 40 years ago when they're wearing leather helmets, or 50 or 60 years ago. And so it's kind of a double-edged sword in the sense that you got extra protection, but now guys are coming at your head.
Oh, definitely. Like I said, the game's just changed that much. And you said you touched on it with the equipment's better. The guys are getting quicker. They're stronger. They're physically, they're better athletes they probably were before, you know, strength-wise.
Oh, absolutely. And the other thing, so a couple suggestions. One is put the helmet on and get the face mask going on the helmet. Get something in front of the mouth, not just the plexiglass in front of the eyes. You got to get something in front of the mouth, like on a football helmet. And number two, if you're going to put the helmet on, you might as well buckle the chin strap. There's a lot of guys skating around out there. The chin strap hangs 13 inches below their chin, Drew. Have you seen this?
Oh, yeah.
It hangs there like a bucket handle.
Mm-hmm.
I don't understand that. Why don't you cinch that thing up?
Something to grab.
How much is that going to screw you up?
I don't know. I mean, as far as the helmet goes, maybe that's a pride thing we have. We don't. I mean, it's considered. If you're a scorer and you don't go in the corners or you know, don't. If you're a finesse guy, you can wear a visor to protect your eyes, but if you're any kind of guy that, you know, gets your nose a little bit dirty or whatever, and you put one of those on, you're kind of...
You're sissy.
Pretty much,
see,
yeah.
It's weird. There's a lot of weird...
There's a code that I don't understand. It, but
there's like the hockey bravado thing, Drew, which is, first off, we don't want to wear helmets. And
right.
then when they made the helmet rule, I guess in the early 80s or mid-80s or something like that, there were some guys who'd been in the league before the rule, and so they got to not wear the helmets while everyone else wore the helmets. So that was a sort of cool, defiant move, but because it's been around long enough, those guys have retired or had concussions and are on the vegetables now. But so now they put the helmets on, but they won't buckle the chin strap, and they won't put the face guard in front of the thing. I'd have the helmet on with duct tape going around my head, under the chin, and around the top of the helmet. And I just wear a football helmet. I can't, everyone wears a mouthpiece, though, right?
Pretty much, yeah, for the most part.
All right. But how's the dental work going on you guys?
We've had a guy lost his teeth back-to-back weeks.
Yeah, he lost, I think. Yeah, I actually was... Someone shot a puck, and I tipped it into our own guy's mouth, and he lost, like, 5 teeth. And then he got them all fixed. Got them all fixed, and then about a week later, he got an elbow or something. But same 5 that he got worked on, just they all came out again.
Oh, my God.
Do you guys travel with a dentist? I mean, I know other teams have physicians, but you should really have a dentist travel with the team.
We need one.
My third and last suggestion is, Drew, you've heard me say this one, but I used to box, and I know it's important to tape your hands. And I know you guys get in a lot of fights, and the first thing that goes is the gloves, and now you got the bare knuckles. But it seems to me like you could easily break a knuckle or break a finger when you're punching out some other guy's dental work. Wouldn't you want to tape your hand a little bit, tape your fingers up?
Like
you know,
a boxer.
Yeah, sort of like a boxer. You still have use of your fingers. You're wearing those big, fat gloves anyway. It's not like you're doing... origami or something.
Yeah.
It's not a finesse thing. Why not tape the hands? That way you throw the mittens down or the gloves down and the guy knows you're all business. A, number one. B, number two, you don't break your knuckles.
Well, they don't allow any of that stuff. You know, they don't allow any tape on the hand.
Oh, they don't?
Above the wrist. No, you can't have any tape above your wrist. You can't have a Band-Aid on it. You can't have anything here. You're getting real trouble.
Well, there's an answer.
There you go.
No one's ever given me an
answer.
You
always wondered why. There you go.
So if you broke your finger, like you might in football or something, you couldn't just tape it up or tape it to the next one.
You could. You can't get in a fight after that. I mean, you can.
You can't take your gloves off.
You can't take your gloves off and get in a fight, or you get, I don't even know what the penalty is. You'll get some kind of slap on the wrist. I don't know what it is, though.
But I'll tell you. And another thing, my one last hockey ass-kissing thing. This is just some ass-kissing. Football players, you know, they play once a week because they just couldn't do it any more than that. And even by the end of the season, they're all dropping like flies. I mean, half the starting lineup's out by the 12th or 13th game of the year, and that's lucky. Basketball, baseball, they play more games because they can, especially something like baseball, not so physically demanding. Hockey seems to me to be a little more like football, and so I don't understand how you get 90 games in. I mean, I don't understand why there's not more injuries in hockey. I mean, like football, like more knee injuries, more stuff like that.
I don't know what. I mean, football's, like you say, you couldn't play a 40-game schedule in football, and it's tough. But hockey's, I mean, I'm biased, but I think hockey's the toughest. You're playing 82 games, and especially with the travel we have on the West Coast. And I don't know why there's not more injuries. We've had a bunch this year, a lot of guys pulling stomach muscles or whatever it is. But, you know. I don't know. I guess that's why they hire all the trainers, keep us loose and flexible.
But it's like, what, 3 or 4 games a week sometimes?
Pretty much, 3,
almost every other night.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's such a violent, aggressive, hard-hitting, fast-moving sport to do. I mean, Drew, it seems like you do once, and then you'd take 6 months off.
Yeah.
Then you'd warm up for 3 weeks, and you'd do it one more time. But 3 or 4 days a week, it just sounds insane. All right, so you guys know how this show goes, don't you?
No.
We punch him up and you mow him down. Brian.
Hey, how's it going?
Hey, you're 19.
Sure am. Okay, my problem, by the way, hockey is great. I like it a lot. I play and there's no way you can watch it on television and like appreciate how hard it is. Just to get that out of the
way. Where are you from?
Michigan.
Oh, all right. Well, there's a hockey place.
Yeah, we're pretty cold up there. But anyway, okay, number one, I would like to say that I'm not a jerk, but I'm 19 years old and a virgin, and it's really starting to get on my nerves when all my friends are talking about all the girls that they're banging, and I'm really getting nothing. I've had the same girlfriend for 2 years, and it's like she's a great girl, and like I like her an awful lot, and I mean she's so smart and everything, but she's really moral, and she doesn't want to have sex before marriage, and I mean,
is she religious?
Well, sort of. She's Hindu, but, I mean, but that doesn't really have a factor. She's just moral and smart, and she doesn't want to act her life.
Yeah, okay. All right, so is she Indian?
Yeah.
All right, what's her name? It's usually a funny one, right?
I would really rather not say.
Okay, but it's a funny name?
No.
Is she moral or modest?
Moral? She's modest, but she's not.
Okay. So she's sort of containing her sexuality,
yep,
modesty.
Yeah, she does.
And that, and that's what?
I don't know how much you guys know about the Hindu religion. I mean, I don't know what you guys talk about on the plane. I don't know what that religion dictates. Are you allowed to have sex before marriage? You know what I mean, Drew? You don't know? Do you know, Brian?
No, I couldn't. Sorry.
Okay, so you're horny. She's not putting out. You're not ready to get married. You don't know what to do.
I'm not ready to get married, and she's 17, so it's like, it doesn't really matter. But see, I'm really starting to bang my head against the wall.
But maybe you shouldn't be in a relationship for a year on, a year out. It's not that time for you.
See, I knew you were going to say that, but it's like, I mean, really, I like everything about this girl except for the fact that she's so slow physically.
Well, you're not going to change her. That's her choice.
Yeah,
it's fine. It's appropriate for her. It's a good thing.
What do you get? Do you get anything?
You mean a little bit of mouth filler?
Yeah.
No.
No. So you just.
It's been 2 years, and I've flipped a hand up the shit sweater. That's it.
And that's it.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's pretty irritating.
All right. So 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, maybe it's time to move on. I mean, listen, I don't want to be a pig, but... No, wait a minute. Let you guys know, because your man talked to Sean and Rob about this. We talked to a lot of people that get hooked up in a relationship at 15, 16 years old, and they can't let it go.
Right.
And I think everyone goes through that. But the reality is you really should let it go and move on. Not because you're not getting laid, but just because you tend to cling to that first one. Do you guys have first loves that you clung to?
I don't know about 3 years, though. I think you got to, yeah.
Yeah, and it just may not be the right time for that relationship. And if it is, if he wants to stay with her, that's who she is, and that's the way she is, and he's going to have to accept that.
Yeah, I mean, if he loves her, stay with her. But, I mean, 19's pretty young, and if she's 17, I think I think you got to play the field a little bit.
Absolutely.
I think that's a little young to settle down with one girl. But
yeah, and hockey, you know, wait a minute, which one? Rob, you married?
I'm married.
Sean, you're single?
Not married, no.
Oh, you're not married?
Not married.
All right. So you do all right with the ladies, right? I think hockey, women are more into hockey players, I think, now than they were when hockey players used to be like unshaven, toothless guys.
Bobby.
Like Klondike something. You know what I mean? Yeah. They said these bizarre names, and they were kind of like a sort of half lumberjack, half street person. But now they're these big, good looking guys. I think the women have woken up to this. Kelly?
Hey.
You're 33.
Hi, guys. How y'all doing tonight?
Good.
A couple things. First of all, I was just curious. I've heard you say before that you don't believe in bisexuality and bye-bye to bye, and I was just wondering what your beef with bisexuality is.
Well, this is Adam you're talking about.
Yeah. I don't have a beef with it. Lord knows I rent all their movies. But I just think it's kind of BS, I mean, to tell you the truth. I think it's just an excuse to screw around on whoever you're with. You know, you get in a relationship, let's say Kelly, you get in a relationship with Sean, you know, he's single. And you announce to him that you're bi halfway into the thing. Well, what you're saying is I'm going to cheat. That's what announcing you're bi is saying.
No.
I'm going to cheat. I'm going to be with somebody else eventually. Don't you worry.
No.
Right. And it's confusion.
No.
It usually means someone screwed with you a little bit, and you can't commit, and you got a little whacked out.
Oh, come on.
Right? Come on.
Straight people, whether you're on the one or the six on the Kinsey scale, people cheat.
Yeah,
monogamy has nothing to do. It's a separate question from sexual orientation.
No, it's an easy out and a quick excuse. You're announcing to your mate you're going to move on soon. That's what you're saying when you say you're bi.
Nah.
All right, now what happened to you?
Me?
Are you bi?
Yeah.
Yeah, all bi people we talked to got somebody did something to them at some point.
Sorry, guys. Going to disappoint you.
What happened?
I'm one of the few people I know that actually had a happy childhood.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, something's up. Who are you going out with now, guy or girl?
I've been with my partner, a woman, for about 5 years.
All right. So you're a lesbian.
You're a lesbian.
That's
you're not
all.
Bisexual.
What's that?
You're a lesbian.
I'm in a committed monogamous relationship.
Yeah,
right.
You're in a lesbian relationship. I mean, if you decide that relationship to end, then you may commit to a heterosexual relationship. I mean...
If I were you, I'd label yourself lesbian.
Right.
5 years of the same groin you've had your face in, that's lesbian. Right?
You have so much class, it's just amazing.
Well, but isn't it? You've been with a woman for 5 years. You don't want to just call yourself a lesbian?
If you are with one person and you love them and you're committed to them, you can still see someone else that's attractive. Doesn't mean that you touch it. You know, you can go to a museum and say, "Oh, it's a Picasso." Doesn't mean you want to take it home.
That's right. But wait a minute. But that's like saying when you're married, you could be also single. You're married.
Uh-huh.
You're married. That's it. You're married,
absolutely.
And you don't touch anything. That's right.
No,
you're married.
Absolutely.
You're lesbian. You don't like other things. You don't like. You don't touch it. You're lesbian.
Stop eating. Drew, you know, it's like the show interrupts Drew's. Would you shut up? The show interrupts Drew's snacking hour. It's when the show gets in the way of Drew's nap and snack time.
True.
Can you not eat on the air, Drew? I can barely get through interrogating a lesbian without Drew spitting up popcorn into the microphone. Now, where the hell was she?
Two.
Kelly. See, that's a lesbian name. Kelly?
Yes, gets it.
All right. Now, listen, just admit you're lesbian and we can move on.
I'm a lesbian identified bisexual.
Okay. But let me explain, too, the other thing with the bisexuals. It's people that are gay or lesbian who aren't that comfortable with it and don't really want to admit it. Like, you show me a gay guy, you show me a guy who's bi, he's gay. All bi guys are gay. You guys know what I'm talking about.
Yeah,
so like, well, I'll blow this gun Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, but then it's right back to the chicks. But that is a bizarre notion, isn't it? No, that guy would be gay.
That guy is gay.
Yeah. Yes, of course that guy's gay. You throw him right off the team.
Yeah.
Kelly, you're lesbian? That's fine. There's nothing wrong with that.
No, of course not.
Just admit it. That's all we're saying. I would be insulted if I was with Kelly as her female partner for 5 years and she was still labeling herself as bi. Well, wouldn't she take some insult
again,
to that?
It's like saying, I've been with you 5 years, but I'm still single.
Right.
It's just not right. It's not right.
Thank you. Is there any gay guys in hockey that you're aware of? It just seems like
not that we're aware of, no.
Seems like a tough sport to get into if you're gay. Although there is something about the ice rink that's alluring, but it's the wrong kind of skates. It's a different one. These ones, they don't have those teeth at the front. It's not serrated.
No toe picks.
No tight spandex.
What if you went out there in a pair of figure skating skates? Just one game. Wouldn't that kind of, you know, make all the news, really stir things up in the league a little bit?
Get a little press, yeah.
Make a statement.
It'll be your last game,
with some tassels on the skates or something. Oh, some kind of, like, spats or something. Jennifer.
Hello.
You're 20. We got to take a quick break, so let me see what your problem is.
Well, my boyfriend was saying something about that he's seen a girl, like, have some, like, ejaculate before, and I want to know if that was possible.
Okay. He saw it firsthand, or is this in a movie?
Who knows with him? I don't know.
You don't sweat the details, do you? You didn't ask if that was...
Well, it doesn't... If it was another girl, I don't want to know. If it's a movie, I really could care less.
Okay. You got a sister?
No.
Brother doesn't have a lot of hair on him?
No.
It just really sounds like my kind of woman. She doesn't want to know. She doesn't ask. She doesn't care. All right, hang on there, Jennifer. We'll get to that. Sean O'Donnell and Rob Blake are both here from the Kings. We'll take ourselves a little break. Drew, I think ironically enough, Drew will stop eating during the break and
yes,
then resume his snacking when the mic heats up. We'll be back after this.
Loveline, Adam Carolla, and Dr. Drew. Phone number is 1-800-LOVE-191.
Hey, it's Loveline. Rob Blake and Sean O'Donnell are both here from the Los Angeles Kings. Rob, MVP of the Kings last year?
Yeah.
That's pretty damn good.
Yeah, things worked out pretty good last year. It's fun.
And Sean, number two on the team in penalty minutes, is that?
That's my only claim to fame, yeah.
It's a bizarre sport where you get... You're
rated on your penalty
You're rated
minutes.
On penalty yeah. minutes. Oh, that is fantastic. Drew?
Yep.
You back?
I'm back.
Everything's good?
Yep.
Now hockey, now, well, let's see, how many games left in the season? Like 25 games or
something like that, 25, 20, between 25 and 30, who knows?
Now, what do you guys have to do to make the playoffs?
Win 23 of them.
Yeah.
Well, no problem.
No, we got we're 6 points out of the playoff spot. So three games out. Basically, three wins out, yeah.
Now, is the team confident they'll make the playoffs?
Yeah, we get a big game. We play Edmonton on Wednesday. That's the team we're chasing right now.
Right.
They're in eighth spot, so that's a big one for us on Thursday.
And how many teams are in the league? Pardon me for my ignorance here.
26, I think.
Yeah.
And how many will make the playoffs each year?
8 in each conference, so 16 total.
Right. All right, so the odds are on your side. At least sort of mathematically.
Yeah, should be.
Right now they're not, but they should be.
Oh, Drew, you ever play any hockey?
I tried once, but it didn't work.
I always thought the whole hockey thing was a great idea, and I thought I'd be good with the puck and all that, but I never learned to skate, and if you can't skate, you're screwed, right?
Can't do it.
There's nothing with tennis shoes. No.
And it's not just skating. You got to skate in all kinds of directions, be able to stop and start.
No,
skate.
That is the most amazing thing. The whole going backward thing is mind-boggling to me. And then I realized watching these guys skate, you know, when I notice it most is after they score the goal, the celebration. because when they're skating down the ice or they're skating to score the goal, I realize they know what they're doing. Or they're evading somebody. But after they score the goal, they're just having a good time. And I don't even think they're thinking about their feet.
No.
No, it comes pretty. It's like walking for us when we get on.
Yeah, they run on their toes. They stop and then they go backwards. And then the rest of the team goes plowing into them. If I'm on the ice and I'm on skates and some guy comes plowing into me, I'm pissed because it takes me like 4 days to get up. Well, I like once in a while when the guys have to walk out there in the wingtip shoes for some sort of presentation or something. That's always my favorite part. I want to get on that Zamboni. Is there any kind of ride-along on the Zamboni, like a ride shotgun on the Zamboni?
He has a guy that stands in the back usually, right?
Yeah, I mean, sure. We have our PR guy here behind us. I'm sure he could arrange something.
I'd like to ride along on the Zamboni.
Why? Why?
The celebrity ride-along.
Why?
It's just been a dream.
Oh, man.
You know what I mean?
You got too much time on your hands. Let's go to call.
You don't think that's a pretty cool idea, riding on the Zamboni?
Nope.
When's the Zamboni? It hits the ice before the game, after everyone's warmed up and everything, right?
Period.
And after each period.
And after each period. Yep. And does he bother at the end of the game?
Yep.
Yeah, he'll probably.
We got these leagues to play after we're done, these men's leagues, so they'll redo the ice for the
season
when we're done, yeah.
Hmm. I wonder if the guy ever shows up drunk. And I mean, what can you do in a Zamboni? It goes like one knot or something. Hey, one more thing, too.
Oh, Adam.
Let me say something. With the goalies in the water, I don't think they need to bring the water out there with them. I really don't. I don't think their job requires that much water. They stand on a block of ice.
Both our goalies have cramped up during the season.
I don't understand.
Other sport do they drag? They don't drag the water out in any other sport that way. I don't understand why. It distracts me to see the Gatorade bottle sitting on top of the net. It's too casual for me. It's like they drag some junk out and set it. I mean, you might as well have like a Walkman and a book or a candle back there or something, too. It's unprofessional.
Goalies are a whole different entity. They're all a little whack in the head.
Just make this suggestion. Suggest that you just drink the water when you're off the ice, and when you go on, all you got to do is stand on that block of ice for a few minutes, and you get to go off eventually and get some more water. I just don't like the idea of them bringing it out there. Jennifer?
Yeah.
You're 20?
Yes.
All right. So your boyfriend mentioned...
Nobody heard that.
Okay. He saw a woman have an orgasm.
Yeah, and we've been together for 3 years, and he was kind of like, well, how come you haven't ever, you know?
Oh, that. Well, first of all, he is actually right. It can happen.
Oh.
But not everyone can do it, and sometimes it's not just an ejaculate. Sometimes it's urine.
Oh, that's real attractive.
Well, it's different for different people, and, you know, it's... some women do that, and some women do it all the time. Some women do it some of the time, and some women don't do it at all. And it doesn't have any meaning to it. Doesn't mean you're not orgasming. You're not orgasming as intensely. It's just what you do.
Okay.
All right, Jennifer.
Okay.
And you have an orgasm with him?
Yeah, I just have never had anything spew out of me, and I guess he was disappointed or something.
Oh, he is. Oh, please.
Yeah, this is why guys shouldn't, they really shouldn't be able to look at pornography when they're in a relationship.
Why is Jennifer being wasted on a guy?
Except for me. What?
Jennifer's being wasted on a guy like that.
No, she's an idiot for dating this guy, too. All right, Jennifer.
All right, thanks.
All right. Hey, let me ask you guys a personal question. You're on the road a lot. Do you get a lot of that pay-per-view porn in the hotel rooms? That's all going right back to the team account, right?
Have you ever done two back-to-back?
I did a back. I had like almost a hat trick.
Oh yeah,
almost a hat. Well, I think I may have had an assist when I helped the maid out. I threw the towel right onto her cart. I think that counted as an assist the following morning.
Did it crack or anything when it hit?
It actually broke the handle off the cart when it hit. But you travel around a lot. You're in a hotel every night. The team's picking up all the room service and all the things. Would they, if you ordered a blue movie, would they frown on that?
No, not at all. They, you know, we got a bunch of guys that are on the team that are married or, you know, with girlfriends. And, I mean, you're human. You go away for 10 days and,
right.
You know, guys got to do certain things. So they'll throw on.
You got to let off a little steam.
Exactly. So, yeah, that kind of stuff happens.
Yeah,
but now the team doesn't pay for it. They pay for the room. And then we get whatever food we get or whatever.
Oh, really? You have to give them the credit card?
Yeah, you got to do that whole thing.
Oh.
So you got to go down in the morning and pay for whatever selection you pick that night.
That is an insult. You two need some better representation.
Yeah.
There's no way Gretzky drops a credit card when he pulls into a hotel. There's no way. Gretzky's paying. Yeah, he had like a fruit platter. That's $7.45. No way. He's got that in his contract. That's what you guys got to get, too. Because that porn can add up. I mean, it's a long season. There's a lot of road tours going on. All right. We're going to talk to Ed. Ed.
Hi.
Hey, you're 39. How are you?
Yeah, I'm a gay man, and I'm a big fan of your show, I'd like to say first. But I'm also a big hockey fan. And I know Sean O'Donnell is 27 and has been married, and he dyes his hair blonde. And I was wondering if that means anything to guys like me.
You guys have any idea who this is?
T-Bone.
Hey, buddy.
What's going on?
It's Tom Arnold, everybody.
Oh, man. That's
Thanks,
true,
Tom.
Though, Sean, what is the deal? You are single.
Just haven't found that special person, Tom.
Yeah, I've met a couple of your special people.
Cut the commercial.
Hey, you guys got to let it all hang out on the show. That's the thing. You got to tell things you normally wouldn't say. That's how you become a good guest.
Right. See, Tom's a great guest.
Yeah.
Tell the stuff you say at your parties, at your place. You know that. That's the good stuff.
All right. Well, we still got a half an hour. We'll see if we can unwind a little bit. We're just warming up.
Okay.
Yeah. See, Tom doesn't have any trouble climbing out of his shell.
Yeah. Exactly.
He is an open book, and some of the pages are stuck together, unfortunately.
Well, I have so much trouble in my personal relationships.
Hey, Tom, when are you coming back on the show?
Hey, anytime.
Really?
Let me know, Tom, so I can put a phone call in.
Oh, please do.
I want you to know, Tom, that it was just the other day. Drew, was it not just a day or two ago somebody asked us who our favorite guest was, and you said Tom Arnold, and then I yelled at you?
Yep.
Oh, wait a minute. I was supposed to say that part.
But that's what happened.
All right, but... Drew loves you, Tom.
Well, I know he does. I saw that in Playboy.
He put you... That's right. Yeah, I'm into you, too. Just not to the extent that Drew is into you. Drew is really in love with you.
Well, I appreciate that. I'm in love with him. I'll come back soon. You love
me? It's me and Sean.
Yeah, I see. Exactly.
All right, I'm getting a little jealous now.
All right, Tom.
I'm homosexual.
Drew, please now.
All right, guys.
Thanks, Tom.
Come on anytime, Tom.
Okay, buddy.
Take care. Bye-bye.
Tom, the great Tom Arnold, everybody. And I guess he goes to a lot of Kings games.
Yeah,
he's a big fan.
He's good friends with one of the guys on the team, Russ Cortinel. So I got to know him a little bit this year. He's a good guy. He's a funny guy.
Drew, you ever go to any Kings games?
Long time ago.
When, Rogie Vachon was a rookie?
It would have been, like, seriously, probably 1971.
Really?
Yes. Yeah. The Forum had just been built.
Oh.
Think about that.
Geez, yeah. Okay. Oh, and you guys are moving to the Staples Center. Yeah, this is good.
Yep.
That's much better. So the Forum, what are they going to do with the Forum? Are they going to fill it with dirt and put, like, pot plants in there?
I don't know what the hell they're going to do with the thing. I don't know.
That'd be a good idea, though, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Right on.
Melissa.
Yeah, hi.
You're 20.
Yep, I had a comment about your bisexual call.
Uh-oh. Yeah?
What?
Yeah, go ahead.
I actually work with a sex therapist who does research in that area,
mm-hmm.
and sexual orientation isn't defined necessarily by behavior, but by attraction. So
right.
She could be in an exclusive relationship with a female and still be attracted to men, whether she acts on it or not, that would still make her bisexual.
Yeah, I'm just saying, why announce that? I mean, maybe technically in a textbook you're bisexual, but why announce it to the world and your partner that you're bisexual, especially if you're committed and you have no plans of acting on that? I mean,
sort of like you're a de facto lesbian.
Right.
You know, you may be bisexual by definition, but the fact is, for the time being.
Yeah, it just whoever you're with is what you are at the time. I there's like a couple exceptions. I think David Bowie, and but maybe another rock star too. But you have to make a certain. You have to own your own jet, and then we can talk about you being truly bisexual.
Hey, Melissa, do you have any data about bisexuals and how many are just really confused from history of abuse, and how many are a mature sexual orientation and.
You know, I haven't seen any research on that.
Yeah, it's hard stuff to pull out of the data.
I know women change a lot more easily.
Much more easily.
Than men,
yeah.
But,
Women really are basically all bisexual. That's sort of the way some people look at it.
That's the way I've always looked at it.
but most don't act on it, obviously.
Well, I know. The thing is according to my research, the movies I've seen, a lot of them start off lesbian, but then when the guy comes in,
I see.
Like when he's done cleaning the pool or something, and he wants to get some lemonade, he comes into the house, Then they go back to a heterosexual because there's a guy there.
I see.
So according to the movies I watch, they're only lesbian because they're trapped somewhere without a man.
I see.
You guys know what I'm talking about, right? Sean, don't you think it's a crime that they butcher up those porn movies on the road in those hotel rooms?
Yeah, well, that's the good thing in Canada, actually.
That's what I was going to get to.
They're pretty solid up there.
Really?
You see, you pretty much see everything. But in the States, I don't know if it's some kind of organization or something, but they pretty much crap all the decent scenes out of them.
It's sort of a retarded modesty.
Yeah.
You know, which is. You're paying $10. You're up late at night. You've ordered the movie. God knows what you're doing in front of it. If that TV set could talk, the stories it could tell.
It's sort of like blacking out the eyes or something.
Yeah, you're already there. Let's just admit we're pigs and enjoy ourselves. I mean, it's true. They cut it up to the point, and I want you guys. I hope you take this in the spirit in which it's intended, but. After watching one of those for an hour, I've never wanted to see a penis so badly in my life. You know what I mean?
I don't know how you get through watching the whole hour. Usually I get about 15 minutes in and then I don't want to turn the thing off.
Well, my problem is I think I'm going to miss something. Like some chick I went to high school with or something. And then I'm going to curse myself. And then I can never have it back. I masturbate. I do it like I'm never going to do it again.
You always tell yourself you never will.
And then fast forward 20 minutes and... that's out the window. All right, where the hell were we here, Drew? Matt.
Yeah, how you guys doing tonight?
Good. You're 28. You're on with Rob Blake and Sean O'Donnell from the Kings.
Rob and Sean, how you guys doing?
Good. What's going on, Matt?
Not much. Big hockey fan. I played in college until I had hurt my knee, and I'm one of those crazy ones that was a goalie. So
maybe you can answer the water question.
Yeah, that's what I was just going to say. You definitely do have to have the water out there. I've had the cramps in my calves quite often. So
no, it's because you're... in a readied position for too long?
Yeah, you're down in a squat there for so long that the legs take a major abuse.
Yeah, well, what about the 80 years where they didn't bring the water out there?
Yeah, I guess they were more men than we are now today. I don't know.
Okay.
But any advantage you can have, whatever.
Man, I kind of miss those old goalie masks with the cobra and stuff, you know, stenciled on it. I'd like to bring those back.
Those guys were really crazy, the ones that played goalie with no mask. Those were the crazies.
So, Matt, what's up tonight?
Got an ex-girlfriend of mine went to the gynecologist. This was about 6 months ago. She went to the gynecologist. She was having some problems. And turned out she has HPV.
Uh-huh.
And... she said that she'd only been with one other guy before that, and that when they got together, he had never been with anybody else. So, I'm kind of led to believe that it's me that gave it to her.
All right, this is an interesting place to stop because we got to take a break. But Drew, it's the that's the warts.
Yep.
You know all about the warts.
Yeah.
All right, we will talk about the warts more. More Rob, more Sean, more Kings, more hockey. All after this.
I feel so liquidy.
Really?
Yeah.
You're listening to Loveline with Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew. Loveline will be right back.
Hey, it's the Loveline. Rob Blake and Sean O'Donnell are both here from the Kings. Just a breath away from the playoffs. I think they're going to make it, Drew. You're not a gambling man. We were just talking during the break how one of the greatest moments in hockey history is when one of the guys from, what was it, the Flyers or what team? Was it
Boston
Detroit?
Bruins.
Oh, the Bruins?
Yeah.
It was about 12 years ago now, maybe?
20 years ago.
Was it that long ago?
Yeah, it was late 70s.
Some guy in the fan was, well, maybe it happened a couple times. I swear it happened 10, 15 years ago. But anyway, or maybe it's happened more than once, but some guy in the stands was taunting the players for a while, and they finally went over the top into the stands, started kicking the guy's ass, and then beating him with his shoe. That was
him with his own shoe.
Yeah, to be beaten by your own foot apparel is really bad. Oh, I guess hockey fans are pretty raucous, right? I mean, they're the loudmouths, right?
Especially Boston, New York.
So you just have to deal with that constantly, right? Yeah.
You get it everywhere you go.
And every time you skate by, I mean, will you be aware of the same guy?
If he's behind the bench, probably. When you're sitting there, you'll hear it more than when you're on the ice.
Right.
So if he's right behind you, yeah, you're going to hear him, everything he says.
Usually they have, like, behind the visiting team bench, usually they have kind of a buffer area where you can't quite get at them. But when you go to the penalty box, I mean, you're in this little cage, almost this little box, and the fans are around you. And, I mean, I've seen guys get water squirted on them or beer poured on them or...
Oh, really?
Crap yelled at them for like 2 minutes. Yeah.
And you can get out of the penalty box and into the stands okay?
Well, no, that would take some work. And usually they have one or two guys in there with you to let you out of the box, and they're kind of slash security guards. So if you'd,
right.
any kind of ruckus would start, you know, they can call the security and have the guy taken out or whatever, or prevent you from doing something ridiculous.
I just love the idea that they beat the guy with the shoe. Sure, as I know as a physician, you frown on that, but as
most kinds of beatings.
Against beatings in general?
Just in general. It's a pretty radical position I take.
Jeez. Well, you learn something every day about Drew. All right, where were we?
Six.
Six? No. Don't draw it that way, then. I can't read that. Matt?
Yeah.
28. Yeah, HPV.
Yeah, you guys were saying, you know, that's one about the warts. I don't have anything like that. I've never had any.
HPV is the warts.
I've never had any.
Well, you do now. If you didn't before, you do now. You don't have to actually see the warts to have the wart virus.
Okay.
So, there you go.
Okay, so, is there any way to test for that, or what are the byproducts of it?
Nothing for men.
Okay,
for women, increased risk of cervical cancer and certain subtypes of the virus.
So, it's always transmissible?
Virtually.
Okay.
And it tends to only hang around for a few years, typically. In men, you can sometimes bring out or see the pre-wart conditions by basically pouring vinegar on the penis and shining a black light on it. They'll sort of turn up that way. But it doesn't matter, really. I mean, if you want to, sometimes...
There's a humiliating experience.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
I mean,
talk to her doctor, see if they want to do anything with you or not. Probably they will not. But you should, whether you had them before or not, it doesn't really matter. She has them, and you've been having unprotected sex with her yet?
Yes.
So that means you have them. And there you go.
Okay.
All right.
All right, Matt.
So, but I mean, as far as you said that it usually only hangs around for a few years?
Well, but it's very hard to know when it's gone away, so you basically have to consider yourself infectious from now on.
Let me ask you guys a question. Do they give you, you know, sort of morality speeches about being on the road and being big-time pro athletes and putting condoms on and all that kind of stuff?
They have someone that comes around once a year at the start of the year. I don't know exactly what Dr. Carolla takes that guy's place.
No, it reminds me of the Woody Allen scene from Love and Death where they put on a little skit for the soldiers.
Right, about a venereal disease. Yeah. But I mean, it would seem.
I have a sore.
It would seem to me that this could be a pretty big issue. I mean, if somebody went out on the road, knocked somebody up, or got some sort of a venereal disease, or you know, lawsuits, or what have you. I mean, it's, you know, and you guys are kind of targets out there.
Well, yeah, that's exactly what they say, and that's happened. You know, there's you know, girls or women or whatever you want to call it that'll look at you. They'll look at you and just, you know, guys are making now the money they're making. They'll look at it as an investment. They'll say, I can do this with this guy, and whether I get pregnant or not, who cares? And, you know, I can suck up for some cash or whatever. So
why you always go for the oral sex, right?
Well, I don't mean no pun intended, but I can get some cash out of him.
Suck
so.
All you like. Good luck. Tell me if you get a nickel through there. I'll be surprised.
It'd be pretty good if you could.
So they give you now. Is there something in your contract like that says? Listen, no acting like an a-hole on the road.
No, nothing like that.
Really? Yeah. Shouldn't there be some sort of morals clause or something? Well, I don't want to sound prude, but I mean.
I think guys just understand if you want to stay in the league,
right?
You know, don't screw up too bad.
What about the booze policy? Well, obviously, no drinking during the game. But let's say after the game, you guys win or you lose, whatever it is, you head back to the hotel and you decide to go down to the bar for some of that high-octane Canadian lager. Is there a problem with that?
Most teams are no hanging out in the hotel bar. They just
that's the policy.
Yeah, they just, you know. A lot of times you'll have a curfew, soft curfew on the road. You go to a local spot or, you know, you go up to your room or, you know, if there's a mini bar or order some room service with a couple of drinks and then...
What is the curfew, by the way?
It all depends
on... game, what, 11:30 before?
Yeah, 11:30, 12, and then after a game. It depends on whether you're playing the next night, if you won, whether you don't play for a couple of games, it varies.
Is it something that's announced at the end of the game in the locker room, or do you just know by virtue of whatever your schedule's going to be and whether you won or lost and all that?
Pretty much announced.
Yeah, the night before games is pretty much just common sense. You play the next night, be in your room 11:30, 12 o'clock. But after games, you know, like I said, depending on a win or a loss, the coach will put up anywhere from 11:30 till just be on the bus at 9 tomorrow morning kind of thing.
Drew, it sounds like a decent life to me.
Well,
traveling, chicks.
You've been on the road. You know how horrible it is.
All right. No, it sucks, actually. You're right. Just Drew and I leave town for 2.5-3 days. And
come back crying.
We have to go to a retreat for a month just to recover. Okay. We are going to... We'll tease a call. I know. We'll tease a call, and then we'll say bye to the guys, and then we'll go to break. Mike?
Hello.
What's up?
Hey.
You're 21.
My brother-in-law he's 12 years old, and a girl came over the other day and said that she's pregnant by him.
Brother-in-law?
Yeah.
So your wife is young?
Yeah.
And she has a brother who's 12. I don't know, that sounds bizarre that your brother-in-law is 12.
Yeah, she's 17.
And he got a woman pregnant, supposedly.
Yes.
Okay.
I was wondering, is that even possible?
All right.
This is a fantastic family. Thank God you guys are going to miss this. It's funny, you think of your brother-in-law as some guy you put a few beers back with or helps you come over and rebuild a deck or something.
Yeah.
Or maybe he does a little networking for you and gets you a salesman job at his firm. It's a brother-in-law, he invites you to open house of the sixth grade. Oh, my God. All right. Rob? Sean, thank you very much for coming in. We know you guys have a busy schedule, and we do. It's been too long. There's nothing wrong with coming in on this show and having a good time.
Not at all.
Listen, all you Kings guys, I know the Kings guys get a little uptight sometimes because they think these guys are going to come in and talk about all their dirty secrets and laundry on the air. But as it turns out, I think it's pretty good publicity for the team. So
it's great publicity.
You guys ought to come back, bring your friends, and bring me like a stick or something next time, you know?
Okay.
All right. Wait a minute. What'd you say, Mike? No, Mike wants a jersey. He already got one. All right. We do appreciate it, guys. Good luck to you, and we hope to see you in the playoffs. And we'll come back and talk to Mike and his young brother-in-law after this.
This is Loveline.
Loveline will be right back.
On 92.1 KFMA.
Hey, it's Loveline. We're going to take a quick 10-second station identification, and we'll be back with more Loveline in 10 seconds.
This is Loveline on
radio
station.
Illegal broadcasters.
92.1 KFMA. Green Valley, Tucson.
I'm in pain. My breasts hurt.
Easy there, Drew. Hey, it's the Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. It's Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Rob Blake and Sean O'Donnell have both left the building. They were nice enough to stop by and represent the Kings. They're big, strong guys, those guys. Jesus, I'd hate to have one of those guys coming at me on skates.
You're attracted to them.
I appreciate good examples of just about every gender, Drew.
Keep talking about it.
I don't want to get my ass kicked. That's why I'm talking about it. Dr. Drew over there, Adam Carolla over here. I did Politically Incorrect tonight, Drew. I'm not sure if you're aware of that.
I did CNN tonight, Adam. I'm not sure if you're aware of that.
Yeah, no one watches that crappy CNN. But
at least it was on during prime time.
Oh, it was on?
It was live.
Oh, see? I didn't even know it. So who could be watching? Do you have a tape of it?
No, I have a tape of anything I do.
No.
Give me a break.
I try. From Dukes of Hazzard fame.
Oh, how wild is that?
And Lynn Redgrave, who's nominated for a Academy Award, I think, this year.
Who was the fourth?
Some political correspondent or something. Yeah. Good looking, at least, though, but I just I can't recall her name. Heather, something from Fox. Can't remember. Hey, you'll see her tonight. It was pretty good. John Schneider and Lynn Redgrave, locked antlers and would not shut the hell up.
About what?
Oh, whatever the hell we were talking about. Whatever the hell you talk about on that show. The problem is some people just lock in and they just won't shut the F up.
Yeah.
And I know you guys think I'm a loudmouth, but Jesus Christ, I was about to take the chair and bust it over Lynn Redgrave's head.
Bill Maher usually breaks that stuff up.
He didn't. Lynn Redgrave is a nice woman, and John Schneider's a nice guy, but they got locked in on a couple. They went on a couple roles, and it was like I told them at one point, "Hey, you're boring everybody. Take it out to the parking lot." I don't think they could hear me over their incessant chatter, but I mean, they were going off like I don't know, like they had their own cable show or something.
Oh, boy.
All right, I still managed to get a few jokes in though, so you can watch that tonight. No, that show's weird. You never know until you watch it because you can't remember anything. But I give myself like a 7.5, maybe an 8.
So I did
pretty good appearance.
I did We the People, the town hall forum with me and conservatively 65 of my friends.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's going to be great. I'm doing Roseanne tomorrow.
Really?
Yeah.
With Jimmy?
Yeah, sorry about that, Mike.
With Jimmy?
Yeah.
That's good.
We're going to do battle with some crazy female stand-ups or something.
Well, this should be good.
Yeah, I doubt it will. Because here's what... Let me explain, and Drew, please stop me if I'm wrong. What all these things turn into is just some kind of shout-fest cluster F, don't they?
Because nobody focuses them, yeah.
Nobody focuses them.
Yeah.
And it's really the worst radio and it's the worst TV ever when four people are yelling on top of each other.
They put too many people there, and nobody guides the discussion.
Right.
So it's a cluster F.
Let me tell you one thing that's wrong with TV. TV is so paranoid about one moment of downtime.
Yeah.
They are so freaked out about having a beat go by, a rabbit's heartbeat go by without a syllable being heard, that their plan is to sort of
fill it with a bunch of crap.
Yeah, they overload. Yeah. They get a panel, and instead of putting three articulate people who can have a dialogue on something, they put 33 people, and then they all start screaming. And one of them's Mother Love, and she's screaming her big ass off, and you can't get a word in.
Yep. And the host never helps the discussion. They always just broaden it, make more chaos.
It drives me insane.
That's right.
All right. Thank you very much. That's why I'm not doing any of that town hall crap or any of that panel BS. It's a cluster F. Mike.
Yeah.
You're 21, and there's professional loudmouths out there who go on these circuits, and they're on Jenny Jones every other week, and they're on the Lisa show the next week, and all they do is shoot their big, fat, uneducated, unfunny, uninteresting, ugly mouths off. Please, you people, stay at home and drive your husbands crazy, would you? Instead of going out on the TV and bugging everyone else. Sorry.
Mike.
Okay. but is it possible to... When does the male start producing enough sperm to actually fertilize an egg?
It's possible around 12.
12 years old. Mike's question is, he's got a brother-in-law who's 12. Which I still can't get over. And his brother-in-law is 12 and may have impregnated a woman. And how old's your wife?
17.
17.
Yes.
Mike, what is up with this family?
Well,
there's trouble here.
Well,
yes.
It's a good family. They are. I mean, they go to church every Sunday.
Right.
Except
for all that. So now, what's the problem with the family?
The family?
Somebody hit somebody?
No.
Somebody touched somebody?
No. No.
So what's the problem with this family?
There's a lot of. They treat other kids better than the other kids. When there's like this one person in the family who's like the one of the kids who's just like can do no wrong.
And what do they do with the rest of them?
The rest of them. Well, there's the oldest girl and the only boy can do no wrong, and the other two are just like the bad seeds.
And what do they do to them?
They don't do anything to them. They just don't treat them as well as they don't give them as much respect and time as they.
So, mother, mom, and dad are still together?
Yes, they are.
And why the hell did, what's up with your wife? Is she married at 17?
Yeah, we got pregnant last year.
Yeah.
But married because of the pregnancy.
Because of the pregnancy.
Yeah, we were dating for a year before that.
What's with the 12-year-old getting somebody pregnant?
There's, the girl who's supposedly pregnant, she's 16 years old. And she's basically new to the neighborhood kind of deal.
So it may be BS, right?
Well... she told her parents.
There must be something about this 12-year-old that sort of allegation would stick.
Well, no, he told his dad today because we were trying to get at him for the past 3 days. Did you or did you not? And he kept on denying it.
And now?
And now, and tonight he told his dad that, well, I did do it with her.
All right, so there you go.
Right. Hey,
so
Mike,
what's up? Let's get back to where
keep
we started.
Keep an eye on this.
Yeah,
Mike, something's up with this family, please.
You're almost describing an alcoholic family.
Yeah.
Is dad a drinker?
No.
Mom?
A little bit.
What's dad do for a living?
He makes tools.
Oh, that's working around metal.
Metal.
Yeah.
Works at a tool and die place?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, that's a lot of metal. That's nothing but metal. Although it is a step up from the guys who work at the muffler shop because it's a little thicker metal that they're working with, a little heavier gauge. What kind of tools does he make?
He was working for the aerospace industry, but now he's...
That's a step up still.
Yeah.
Working for another company, I can't remember what.
All right.
They make mufflers now.
All right, listen, he's working around a lot of metal, this guy, though.
Yeah.
And you know what? You know my theories about that.
No.
I just let a good fart go in here. It's trouble. Mike, what do you do?
I'm a computer tech.
Okay.
All right, just be careful. I'm glad you married your wife and you're having a kid and your commitment is to that... family.
Mike,
right?
No more kids, though, please.
No.
Okay.
More plant time.
All right.
Take listen, and that doesn't mean pulling out. I mean, she's got to get on some kind of birth control, right?
Yeah, Norplant.
All right,
Mike. Yeah.
Yoo-hoo.
We should give out the
Norplant Award.
Yeah, it's some sort of, we'll take like a cigarette butt and bronze it or something and put it on a plaque.
Yeah.
And it'll be... Well, so far, Mike's an early front runner here in 1999 for the Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew...
Norplant Award.
Or, as the rest of the country would know us, Dr. Drew and Adam. Idiots. All right. Where are we? Thank you, Mike. That's pretty good. Pretty good award music there, Mike. Lori?
Yeah.
You're 18.
Yes, I am.
What is up with your ass?
Okay, well, first I have a question for Dr. Drew.
Right.
And that is there any long-term effects from the Depo-Provera shot? Because I know it's pretty recent, and I went to my gynecologist, and she gave me some information, but she didn't tell me much, and she wasn't really big in helping me with trying to choose birth control method.
No, I would say no long-term problems. I mean, some people get...
I mean, I've heard everything from at first you bleed for like 3 months...
That can happen.
...to, you know, hair loss and stuff.
That can happen. You ask long-term, though.
Yeah.
Long-term, everything goes back to normal.
Okay.
All right?
Okay.
But there are some...
And that includes, like, pregnancy.
What do you mean?
Does that include, like, no problems with children or anything? How long has this been out?
It's been out for years.
Okay, I wasn't
years
sure
near,
about that.
It's
like
never.
I said, my gynecologist wasn't...
It's not new. I don't like it because people... It's sort of a... irreversible event. Once you're taking the shot, that's it. And
for how long?
3 months. And the irregular bleeding can really be a problem, and sometimes it takes quite a while for the normal cycling to develop. And if people don't like how they feel on it, their sex drive goes down, they can get depressed. There's various sort of subtle things, that maybe not so subtle, that people get that you can't go back. And I don't like that. Unless somebody is really irresponsible and doesn't want to do the Norplant, can't take the pill every day, then the progesterone shots may be the place to go.
I got to tell you, Drew, for and I know this has come up before, but for a society that really is trying to discourage pregnancy, unwanted pregnancy, teen pregnancy, people aren't too hip on what's going on.
You know what, Adam?
I mean, Norplant, Depo-Provera, people
really
can't even pronounce it. They don't know how it works.
You know
what I'm saying?
It came up again in this town hall meeting I was in tonight, and it's interesting. As soon as you start talking about these issues, people get defensive. They just get threatened by it. Arianna Huffington, of all things, sort of started bringing this up.
Oh.
No. What?
Let me tell you something about Arianna Huffington.
Hey, she was good.
Arianna Huffington is an intelligent woman,
mm-hmm.
and she's an attractive woman and has that third Gabor sister accent going for her. But everyone who thinks Arianna Huffington's a genius because they see her on all these political shows and she seems so sharp and, oh, what a cutting wit and all that stuff, it's all rehearsed dialogue. She goes and spits out the same crap from one show to the next show to the next show We had her on our show. She's a nice woman, but she's warming over, rewarming over the same material she warms over on every show. So don't watch those shows and think she's making it up as she's going along.
But she has a good body of information that she is
an articulate woman, an intelligent woman. Not the comedic genius that she would like you to think she is.
But it's interesting. You get into these discussions with people about things that affect certain segments of our population, and immediately it becomes sort of a race issue, and immediately it becomes it's all because of poverty,
right?
And that the problem is the way the wealth is distributed, and nobody wants to talk about.
Listen, you poor people shouldn't be having kids. Why can't we say that? Oh, it's racist. It's bigoted. Well, what the hell is everyone talking about? Big pussies. Speak up, you pussies. Everyone's such a chicken ass in this country.
Yeah, but it does smack of restricting someone's rights.
Who cares? Of course you get your rights restricted. There's many rights you have restricted as a poor person. Poor.
Well, you've been poor, right? So you've
been poor my entire life.
Yeah.
So for now, I light Cuban cigars from $100 bills and then laugh like some madman.
The torch
coming out of my ass, but I'm farting caviar, baby. That's what's coming out of my ass. I've been poor my whole life. I didn't have kids. Have kids? Because I was poor. And I couldn't afford them. And I couldn't give them an environment that they could flourish in. I couldn't afford anything for them. So I didn't have them. Because I didn't have money. I didn't have car insurance. I didn't have health insurance for myself, let alone the kids. I couldn't afford prenatal care, diapers. I couldn't afford any of that stuff. So I didn't have kids. And listen, you poor people, I got other... You want to give you a list of other things you can't have? You can't have boats, all right? And you can't have personal watercraft, and you can't have luxury airplanes, and you can't go to Europe every year. There's a laundry list. I could go on for 3 hours of the things you can't have when you're poor. This is one more thing. You can have one if you can take care of that. Two, if you get a raise. But you idiots who aren't working who have four kids... I'd take you out and shoot you. That's my plan. I look at you. I would look at you as a saboteur that's trying to dismantle this country from the inside out. Please.
What if your mom had chosen not to have kids?
Good. I wouldn't have to sit here every night and yap about poor people. She'd be doing me a favor. Reba.
Yes.
I encourage comments from anybody that has a
please
alternative
speak
opinion.
Up, all you idiots. You know I'm right.
You are 95% of the time.
Yeah, I mean, listen, my family had two kids, me and my sister, and
that was two kids too many.
They were in their early 30s when they had how old's my mom? Yeah, my mom's my mom was like 31 when she had me or
that's
something
a
like that.
Then.
Yeah, but even then it was not good.
No, and they didn't have money.
Imagine if they had you guys when they were 19.
Oh. Please.
Well, you have to have the right state of mind, too.
I'd be in an institution right now.
You know what I find weird, though? Now, I hope we don't take bored to be pay people this discussion, but here's what I find unique. You go down to Mexico, you find people living in thatched roofs, mud floors, happy as hell.
Right.
They're in these great relationships with their family. The kids are out playing soccer in the dirt behind the house.
Well.
And, no, look.
Seriously,
my wife and I, we like going in a Jeep and just getting out of the countryside in Mexico and just going around meeting people. And you see all these really happy people who are poor as ass.
Right. This is a little sermon that I kind of speak to people that I work with and my friends, and that is that people tend to judge richness and poorness by our society's standards of money and how much you should have. And when you're talking about people, real people, you find people that are out there and they live in
nothing.
Houses we wouldn't consider fabulous.
Nothing.
And with nothing.
They're settled down.
The richest person in the world because everything they wanted in life they worked for and got.
Yeah, but
and you can't
here.
Tell that person you're poor if they're happy and have everything they want.
Here's the deal: you're always poor if you don't have intimacy and love from important people
and
in your life.
And some of the richest people in the world probably feel poor.
They
every
are
day.
Poor, and that's where we've totally missed the boat in this culture.
Mm-hmm.
And we're giving everybody the wrong message. And poor people, because they often come from detached relationships, which are stressed because of their economic situation, feel empty. And the only way they can fill it is with what the society says is going to make you feel better.
All right.
That'll work.
Listen to me. You can have as many kids as you can take care of. That's my policy.
Yeah. And even age isn't as big a factor, because people can have kids in their 30s or 40s and be horrible parents. And I've seen some good parents come out pretty young and raise terrific kids.
Yeah, and it happens once every 300,000 times.
If you're like me...
Uh-oh.
Oh.
I like someone who can edit themselves.
If you're like me, you can pull out of it okay, as long as you know who you are and what you stand for, and you never lose sight of that.
All right, well,
thank
so what's
you, Reba. I was just complimenting on her on not cussing, and she works the S-word right in.
Oh, I am so sorry.
That's all right.
What's going on?
That is my fault. I had a comment first. You guys are terrific together, and I know that Adam always knocks people for saying he's a role model, and I'd like to say I try to role model myself after both of you. You are terrific. And together, you would make, like, the perfect person.
Thanks.
I mean, study hard, work hard, have goals, but have fun. You know?
Individually, we're a mess.
Live. And say what's on your mind. See, I'm like Adam. I have a big mouth, and I put my foot in it. I do. And I'm opinionated, but I try to be totally open and honest with people. And I'm afraid that I might be hurting myself a little bit right here.
Why?
Well, I got out of a bad relationship a year ago.
Yeah.
And when something's over for me, today's my 27th birthday.
And, happy birthday.
So, you know, I've been thinking a lot. I had this friend, and we started getting close. And we were always teasing each other, you know, about she was my girlfriend or whatnot. It was just a game. It was just a joke, you know, in front of my friends. So she called me last week, and she tells me, and she is a clingy, and she's loud, and she's, you know, like the guys I date. Like, I date guys like Adam. Usually.
Yeah.
Well, you don't know about Adam. He's quiet and withdrawn and hostile.
Honest. He's
off the radio.
Hold on a second. Quiet down there, Reba. You have to weave hostile into the end.
Because I want people to get the picture that you're not just withdrawn, you like repel people. You do.
Listen, I'm quiet and I mind my own business and I'm not real talkative.
As long as nobody comes around. They come around, you're hostile.
Oh, please, Drew. That is so unfair. Look at the girls. They're practically crying because of those allegations you made, Drew. I keep to myself. That's true.
Yeah.
And I mind my own beeswax. But I try not to make people uncomfortable. I try to be friendly. And
Yes.
I'm not a big loud mouth, and I don't go yap. And this is my job. I have to yap, but then I go home and I shut up. Reba?
I do at work, too.
Right, okay,
so what'd you do?
Are you lesbian?
No.
Is she?
Well, yeah, she got together with some girl last week.
All right.
And she called me. She was supposed to come pick me up. She said, I'm sorry I didn't pick you up. I met this girl. We started doing stuff, blah, blah, blah. She ends up telling me this whole big story.
All right.
Then she tells me, it's all your fault. And she's joking. I said, why is it my fault? And she says, because I never felt this way until I started hanging around with you.
All right. Well, it's believe me, that may be a fact, but you didn't turn her into anything. And there's a much bigger story going on with her.
Yeah.
Much bigger.
Yeah. Yeah, nobody turns anybody gay.
Yeah, it might be true that she never had these feelings until Reba started talking to her and kindling them, but it's not because of Reba that it happened.
That is true. Let's see. We're going to take a break. When we come back, we'll speak to Layla. She's 21. How can she nicely tell her best friend to lay off the guy she likes? That doesn't sound real provocative, Drew.
Yeah, but look at the I'm trying to get the calls that have been on hold the longest.
I know, but do you have anything that's a little more provocative?
Line six. All right, how about line five? There you go.
Line five. That's John, who's 19, has a penile curvature. Is there any way to straighten this out? Okay, once it ought to straighten out his crooked penis. We'll deal with that after this.
The phone number for Loveline is 1-800-LOVE-191. Loveline, I'll be right back.
Love line. Hey, it's the Love Line. I'm Adam Carolla. That's Dr. Drew. Dr. Drew is in the other room, taking a sweet time coming back to the studio, but that's all right. Let's see, Mike. Thank you. The extended dance version of Loveline.
It's a good thing I don't hear three quarters of what you say.
That was all good, brother. John?
Yeah.
All right, so you're 19.
Right.
You got the curved penis.
Right. From the base to the top, if you can picture this, it's probably a total of 2 inches to the left.
Uh-huh.
That would be like so, Adam?
So. Well, I don't think you'd be flattered if you saw what finger you're using there, Drew.
It's just the one that's convenient.
I mean, it's
the one I have most control over.
7 inches long.
7 inches.
Two across. Right.
And I'm just
this is the scale here, I understand.
Right, I understand. I says you're curving about an inch because it's half.
Yeah.
Yeah. 2 inches.
Is that about right?
That's a guess. I mean, it's not to where
it's not
extraordinary.
No, it's not extraordinary.
But it's a decent amount of English.
It's a respectable curve.
See, I'm wondering if it would make a difference in my love life. I've been with my girlfriend for 2 years.
What's the matter with your love life?
Oh, nothing's. I mean, she orgasms, but I'm just wondering if she would orgasm more, like if I would hit the spot.
What's
better.
The matter with your love life?
Nothing.
Okay, leave
nothing,
it alone.
Nothing.
It'll be fine. And by the way they correct that, they take a big chunk out of the opposite side of your penis and pull it over to that side and shorten it about that 2 inches.
See, that's what I thought I heard you say one time.
Yeah, so you ask your girlfriend if there's something that she's not happy with in your sex life and try to correct it. I'm certain that one of the things she will not say is straighten your GD penis out.
I can understand them taking the chunk out of half the guy's penis, but couldn't the other half of the guys get the chunk they took out added on to the short side of their penis?
There is a whole collection being distributed for you.
I'm seeing if I can get enough. If every man in America could just take an eighth of an inch out of the center of their penis, as along with my idea, if everyone sends me a quarter, then I could pay for the operation. That's good, Drew.
Everyone sends you a quarter. 300 million people send you a quarter. Think about that.
Oh, that'd be nice. Let me do some quick calculating. Was that $75 million?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's good. But it wouldn't cover postage. Layla.
Hi.
All right, so you're 21.
Yep.
What's the problem?
I have this best friend. I know it sounds really stupid, but it's really hard to talk to her about it. She just broke up with a guy about 6 months ago, and she hasn't been in the dating field. And now that I'm interested in someone, she's moving in on it. And I don't know how to tell her without being rude to get off my territory.
How's she moving in?
We go out together, and we'll see this guy, and she'll, like, run to him, give him a hug before I even get a chance to walk in the door.
Mm-hmm.
And then, like, when he gives me a compliment, she's like, oh, don't I look nice?
Mm-hmm. But if we were talking to her, wouldn't she accuse you of moving in on her man?
See, I was sort of, I met him first. I know that's really stupid, but she was dating his friend.
Uh-huh.
And his friend wants nothing to do with her anymore.
Yeah.
And so now she feels kind of ousted out of the situation, you know?
Does this guy work somewhere that you guys show up at?
Yeah.
What is it, like a club or something?
Not a club.
Sporting goods store?
Like a coffee place.
Uh-huh. Okay. Do you have to go with her to the place?
Layla, smoke a little pot?
Smoke a little pot, Layla?
What?
Do you smoke pot?
No.
All right, okay. Drew just got that vibe.
That laugh, yeah.
No, I don't. I don't do drugs.
All right, how do you know the guy's interested in you?
He always gives me back massages. He massages my feet. He calls me. No, just...
Oh, he calls you?
Yeah.
No, are you going out with him?
No.
Okay.
What's he say when he calls you?
Like, hey, what are you doing? Maybe we should go out this weekend. We date, but not, like, exclusively.
You got to learn the lingo, Adam. They're dating, they're not going out. And they're not hooking up, but they're seeing each other. You got all that?
Are you hooking up?
Occasionally.
Ooh. So you're having sex?
No.
Oh, isn't that what hooking up means?
I don't know anymore, Drew. I gotta get the chart out. All right, so let me get this straight. You two are going out on dates.
Uh-huh.
But you're not exclusive.
No.
How many dates have you been out on?
Like three.
Three. And you're making out?
We did once.
You did once. Uh-huh. And why aren't you progressing in your relationship with him?
I don't know. Just taking time.
Just taking time. He's not that interested.
Well, I'm dating other people, too.
Oh, boy. Why are you dating other people?
Why not?
So if you're not that into this guy, why do you care if your girlfriend has sort of some designs on him and wants to date him, too, perhaps?
Well, listen, I understand she doesn't want to share him with her.
That's like sharing sloppy seconds. That's not...
That's against the female code, I guess, isn't it?
What code? Layla.
Yes.
You would like it if this guy would be more interested in you, wouldn't you?
Probably, yes.
Okay, but it doesn't seem like he is, right?
Right.
Okay, and you're a little hurt by that, right?
Yes.
So you're channeling some of that hurt toward your friend, right?
Yes.
Okay. Do you see, Drew? Do you see what I can get at with the kids? All right, so I swear
she smokes pot.
You got to smoke pot with that laugh.
I don't smoke pot.
You just eat it?
No.
No. Okay, so what about you having a conversation with your friend? What about you saying, listen, I'm really interested.
And she denies it. And then today she did the same thing. She's like, I'm going to go give him a hug. And I was like, okay, go ahead. And she's like, does that bother you? And I said, yes. And she did it anyway.
Okay, well, maybe she isn't a great friend, Layla.
Yeah.
Okay.
And maybe when you go out places, you shouldn't include her.
There you go.
Especially to go see the guy who she hugs quite often. It's so funny. People feel like, oh, boy, I got this friend, and she's backstabbing, and she's conniving, and she's vindictive. But what are you going to do? I think I'll call her up. Let's go out.
Yeah.
No, don't go out with her. Yeah. Listen, you are not attached at the hip to your friends just because you decided at some point they were your friend. Sometimes, Drew, think about all the people you once called friend who you really don't talk to. Yeah? It's a lot of people, right?
Sure.
Right.
But they were friends then. I mean, they served that function, important function.
Right, but at a certain point, you moved on for one reason or another.
That's right.
All right, it's important to do that. James.
Yeah.
You're 16.
Yeah.
What's going on?
I don't know how many years ago it was, about 6 or 7. And, first of all, I was molested three times by 3 different people.
Wow.
Once it was by my stepbrother, who lives with my dad, and another time it was another cousin, and the one I'm going to talk about is with the cousin that he married my stepdad's daughter.
I cannot follow that.
Okay, my mom married this guy, Vince, and he has a daughter named Amira, and the guy she married is the son of my mom's brother.
All right.
Who is the guy that abused you? It was one of the guys that abused
Drew,
you.
Drew, don't even.
Yeah.
Okay, I got it.
You do?
Yeah. Shall I diagram it for you?
See what happens when you don't smoke pot? You can work all this family tree stuff out.
Well,
I'm picturing one big fat guy with 9 arms. be that as it may, you had some horrible stuff done to you.
Yes.
Yeah.
And now the perpetrators are back in his life, though.
Yeah.
Now, does anybody know about this?
No, just my girlfriend.
Oh, no. She got married to this guy.
This is the deal. His wife is. We're really good friends. You know, we used to get high together or whatever. And she's just a really good friend. And
she's your stepsister, right?
Yeah.
Right.
I don't want to lose her as a friend. You know,
losing her by alerting. Well, you're going to lose her by perhaps by not having alerted her sooner.
Yeah, I've been in a lot of trouble in my life, and I'm not sure that everybody will believe me. I don't think she will, and I think I'll lose her as a friend.
Yeah, this isn't the kind of thing one makes up, usually.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Especially guys. I mean, let's face it. It's a painful enough process. It's a stigmatized enough situation, and it is even more so for guys. And so for a guy to admit this and a guy to bring this up, he's usually not going to be accused of lying.
Yeah.
And I don't think you would be accused. Okay. But Christ, Drew, would you give him some decent advice, please?
And recently, before I knew my stepsister, they were into dope down in Victorville, and my stepdad brought him down here because he didn't want him into that. Yeah. So now they're all clean and everything, except for me and her get high every once in a while. But now they lived with us for a while because he didn't have a job or anything, and we recently moved, and they lived with us for about 3 months, and then they finally got their own place, but it's right down the street.
Well, here's the deal that concerns me. Your stepsister is going to find out soon enough who she is married, and she's a big girl. She's made her choices. She's going to figure that out.
Boy.
The problem is going to be is if they decide to have kids, then you have some obligation to protect those children because he will abuse again.
Okay.
And I think it needs to be reported I tell you what you do. You make sure you take care of yourself, James. Go get some help. Talk to some people so you get a chance to get through these issues. And if those professionals need to report it, then let them handle it.
All right. Oh, true. Please.
Just get your lighter out at least so I don't have to smell these things. Will you?
Tanya.
Yep.
You're 23.
Yep.
What's going on?
Mike?
Well, I have a 19-year-old girlfriend.
Yeah, I'm wearing slacks tonight, Drew, because I did the PI, so I'm scared to light my farts. I
only afraid they'll catch on fire?
I have a denim policy. I think you're aware of that. Oh, it's in your contract.
It's all denim all the time.
Tanya? Well, uh-huh. with the fart lighting.
Pardon me?
All right, so you're 23.
Yeah, I'm 23.
Yeah.
And I have a 19-year-old girlfriend.
Oh, you're a lesbian?
Yes.
All right.
And I also have a 5-year-old and a 5-month-old.
Oh, boy. Who did something to you?
No, something awful, okay?
Yeah.
Something awful.
How old were you when it started?
What, the awfulness?
Yes.
Oh, 19?
Before that.
Before that?
Like when you were 10.
Pardon me?
Like when you were 8.
When I was 8?
Yeah.
No, I didn't have anything bad happen then.
6?
No.
Where's your dad?
My dad is in the military, floating around somewhere.
Uh-huh.
What's my dad doing?
Actually, I've always been bisexual. I was in a regular relationship with a guy, and he wanted a little kinky sex thing to go on with this girl, and it backfired in his face. So now
it always does. It always does. But let's talk about no. Why you're having kids at a young age and chaotic relationships and abusive guys. Was your dad physically abusive?
Yeah. Well, no, not my dad. My stepfather.
Did your stepfather touch you?
Oh, yeah. I gave my first oral sex to a man when I was about 7.
All right, Tanya, I asked you what happened to you when you were 8.
Well, I don't know what you're talking about. I'm sorry it's late. My kids are still up.
I mean, think about
Tanya, you can't be that stupid.
You said eight years old.
What happened to you?
I'm sorry, Tanya, but we said 19, and you went, 19. We said before that, and you go, nothing.
No, my girlfriend's 19.
Yeah, but we asked what happened to you before 19, and you were like bewildered. Nothing happened to me before 19. What are you talking about?
I didn't know what you were talking about.
Oh, you knew what we were talking about. Don't play stupid with us.
I didn't know.
All right. So you performed oral sex at the age of 7 on your stepdad.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So your mom sounds like a real piece of work.
Oh boy, she's something awful. I tell you what.
Oh boy.
She denies it still to this day. Okay. Yeah. I was actually molested for about 2 or 3 years by my stepfather.
Right.
And I told my mother, and still to this day, to this very day, she doesn't believe that it happened.
Right.
She's still in denial about the whole thing, you know, and my stepfather molested my little sister, you know. She's still in denial about it.
Mm-hmm. Have you introduced her to your girlfriend?
Pardon me?
Have you introduced your mom to your girlfriend?
Oh, yeah, uh-huh.
Payback time.
I'm going home a little bit.
Yeah. Is she happy about you being lesbian?
Yeah, she actually marched for me in the gay parade with a big old sign that says, "My daughter's a lesbian and I'm proud."
Yeah, because my stepdad, my ex-husband.
Did the back of the sign say because the drunken a-hole I married held her down and had sex with her when she was 7 years old?
No, it didn't say that.
Yeah, that's what it should say back on the back of a lot of those good gay parade placards, you know?
It should.
It really needs to be, you know, the sandwich board should have that on the front and then on the back because I married a guy and molested my kid.
Oh, my goodness.
All right. Tanya, this is a disaster, right?
Yeah, well, right now, no.
Well, how are you taking care of the kids?
I work.
Well, who takes care of the kids?
They go to daycare.
Okay, and are they nowhere near your mother, I hope?
No, nowhere near. My mom lives in Oakland, and I'm in Fairfield. She comes down, like, once every few months.
And what about stepdad?
Stepdad, I haven't seen him since I was 9 or 10.
Is he living with mom?
No.
No, he's off.
He's gone. He's been gone for years and years.
Right. And she will not accept the molestation stuff.
No, not at all.
Uh-huh. And yet you can still sort of have a relationship with your mom.
Kind of, but not really. I don't trust her. I will never trust her with myself or my life or my children.
All right. So, Tanya.
It's healthy.
Good. So let me just sort of put this in a nutshell. A couple of guys did a couple of horrible things to you for a couple of years. And now you don't like guys. You're with women now.
Exactly.
Right. All right. So you can't have any more kids.
No, I don't want any more. I'm done.
That is wonderful. How's your girlfriend?
Oh, she's great.
Yeah.
except for the fact, like I said, she's only 19, you know, and she's sometimes still a kid herself. And she's the dominant one of the relationship.
Yeah. God knows what happened to her.
You're going
to
pick people that do weird stuff to your kids, Tanya. Just, that's what you're going to do, so be careful.
Oh, I have been very cautious.
Yeah.
Very cautious. The last guy that I was with, as a matter of fact, he abused my oldest one and had her taken away from me for 2 years. And I just recently got her back. December 17th, I just recently got her back.
Okay.
Because I had to fight and fight and fight to, you know, get her back. And the judge told me he thought it was great that I was with the woman. He said, you need to just stay away from men because it's not doing you any good at all. Because my history...
Well, that's good the judges are playing as social workers.
Progressive judge. You get the one gay judge on the bench. Hey,
it's kind of right. The women are a little less likely to be perpetrators of this crap.
Yeah.
But not impossible.
Yeah.
They can do some weird stuff, too.
How old is your oldest now?
5.
Okay.
Oh, my God.
Drew.
Yeah, my oldest is 5, and my youngest is 5 months.
Mm. Oh, my God.
All right. Tanya?
Yep.
We got your work cut out for you. We got to take a break.
I can't handle anymore.
Okay, Drew's going to kill himself.
Oh, my gosh. I didn't mean to do that to him.
No, we're going
to
have Dr. Art Euline in here after the break replacing Drew. Can you get on the Art Euline hotline, please? Would you, Mike? Oh, for Christ's sake. The humanity. Okay. Nothing happened before 19, though, and certainly nothing at 8. 8, she was being molested at 8.
I know.
She started at 7 and went for 3 years. Okay. We'll be back.
On 92.1 KFMA.
Hey. Hey there. Hi there. Oh there. It's the Love Line. Drew?
Yeah.
You got a call you want to take? Drew, I got to tell you, the gas is really set in.
That's nice.
It's really it's came in like a fast-moving storm, you know?
Yeah.
Jay?
Yeah, what's up?
Hey, 23.
Hey, Adam. Drew, what's up, man?
Not much.
Okay, I have a problem. Well, it's sort of a problem. Might be a problem. Now, I'm on Risperdal.
Yeah.
Or I was on Risperdal as of a couple weeks ago.
Yeah.
They took me off that. Excuse me, I'm having trouble clearing my throat. They took me off that, put me on olanzapine. I noticed an increase in my sex drive. And
yeah.
Just over the last 24 hours, I've noticed, like, a decrease. What should I expect over the next couple weeks?
No telling.
No telling?
No telling.
Oh, good heavens.
But if it's something you don't like, make sure you report it to your doctor and maybe it can be corrected.
Okay, because I used to be like Adam. I used to be like, you know, 3-4 times a day, and I loved it, you know.
Well, maybe that's
too much. Poster child for all the whack-off nuts in the world. One day, you know what I'm going to do? Yeah, this is a underrepresented majority of the country. I'm gonna take these peasants. If they can put down the TV remote for long enough, I'm going to get them on their feet and lead a revolt.
Do you remember? What will they be carrying?
The Che. What is that? Was that legendary? What? Che? You know, C? What the hell's the guy's name from Cuba?
Yeah.
No, where was he from?
From Argentina.
Argentina, thank you.
Well, what happened?
I don't know. I've like a sprinkler key in one hand and maybe like a rolled up swank magazine in the other hand, and we could take over the world. We'd march on the Capitol.
All right, on Masturbators United.
Yeah, I mean, imagine that.
Remember that guy that met us in the airport in Washington, D.C. and before we got in the plane?
Yeah.
Remember I went back to the sort of gift shop area?
Mm-hmm.
He cornered me like, hey, I got to ask you something. Is it okay to masturbate a lot during the day? Okay. Middle of the airport.
That's right. True. Did you ever think all that med school would pay off with these kinds of dividends?
Oh, God.
You're cornered in a D.C. airport talking about whacking off with some crazy local. Lauren.
Hi.
Now you're 15.
Yeah. I slept with my sister's fiancé about a week ago.
How old is he?
He's 25.
Mm-hmm. You didn't really, did you?
Yeah.
You're making this up.
I want to know if I should tell her or not.
You're making this up, right?
No.
Why'd you do that?
I don't know, like, kind of the heat of the moment kind of thing.
Do you hate your sister?
I haven't told my sister.
Do you hate your sister?
No.
But you want to know whether you should tell her?
Yeah.
What do you think this is going to do to her?
Oh, you got to hate your sister.
I don't hate her. It's just
think about it for a second. First off, you wouldn't sleep with her fiancé if you didn't have some ill will toward her. Secondly, you would never consider telling her. So, what'd she do to you?
Well, I don't know. We kind of had grudges when we were younger, but...
There it comes.
Listen, I'd be the greatest comp in the world, Drew. It's all motive, everybody. That's all you need is motive. Nothing just exists out there. There's no really random acts.
No.
So you had a few grudges.
You had a score to settle.
I didn't do it because I hated her.
You did not do it.
I didn't do it because I hated her.
Yeah, but you did not do it.
Yeah. Well,
so not doing it is because you would have not done it if you didn't hate her.
Well, I kind of started liking him because he made a pass at me.
Oh, but he's a colossal asshole. I mean, this is a disturbed, aggressive, pathetic shell of a man who's disrupting a sacred relationship and going to marry the sister of a woman he's making pass at who's 10 years his junior. This guy had to be
a criminal.
Yeah.
Should I tell her not to marry him?
How old is your sister?
She's 20.
She's 5 years older than you. And why the grudge with the older sister? I mean, what kind of stuff did
Lauren,
she do to you?
Lauren, here's something I want you to understand.
Please.
No. Here's something I want you to understand. You are not of an age to render consent in most states. And what state are you in?
California.
You're not an age to render consent. So technically, you were raped.
Okay.
You need to tell this to your father.
Oh, he's not around.
Your mother. Your stepfather.
Okay.
Some parent who is reasonably trustworthy.
Would you trust stepdad if he was around?
Yeah, but somebody's got to handle this guy.
Well, yeah.
And not Lauren.
Do you have a stepdad?
Yeah, I do.
All right. Is he a piece of work?
No, he's a nice guy.
He's a nice guy?
Yeah.
Well, he must not have been around very long. Where's your dad?
My dad, he walked out from the family.
Right.
My dad's a piece of work.
And how long ago did he walk out?
When I was 7.
Yeah, that's nice. And you haven't seen him since?
I see him like maybe once a year or something.
Right. That's fantastic. How many brothers and how many kids do you have?
It's just me and my sister.
You and your sister. All right, so now what is the beef with the sister? What is the grudge to settle?
Well, I don't know. She was always really mean to me when I was little. But, I mean, I didn't do it because I was mad at her or anything.
Right. Well... Except for the part about her always being real mean to you when you were little and you having a little bit of a grudge with her. No, you're gonna tell her, and that's going to send her through the roof, and it's going to be a little payback time for all the crap she did to you when you were a little kid, right?
Yeah, I just think, like, if I tell her, then she's going to be, like, hold a grudge against me for the rest of my life, and
yeah
I'm going to have to see her.
That may be true.
Is she pregnant?
No.
Does she have any kids?
No.
Why is she marrying this guy?
I guess she's been going out with him for like 2 years.
Yeah.
So.
How's your mom? Can you speak to her at all?
Yeah, I can talk to her about anything.
So. All right, you got to talk to her about
that. You talking about anything?
At 15, you slept with your sister's fiance. If you can talk with her about that.
Yeah, I can talk to my mom about anything.
All right, tell her about this.
Mm-hmm.
This guy is a criminal. Do you understand?
Yeah.
He is a horribly flawed individual.
A predator. Asshole. Yes.
Do you understand that, Lauren?
Yes.
And you know what's going to happen? He's going to marry your sister. He's going to screw around on your sister. He's going to get your sister pregnant. And he's going to do to their kids what your dad did to you. Now, is that what you want?
No.
No. Okay, but you understand that's exactly the road that your sister is on.
Maybe
because
worse.
That's what your dad did.
Maybe worse.
Okay.
Okay.
My sister may be up in the ante a little bit with this guy.
Talk to your mom about it, please.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. And stop doing that. Right. Please. I got 25 years old. Oh,
right.
My God.
There we go.
Okay.
Bye. Call 1-800-LOVE-191 to broadcast your problems to the public.
Loveline. It's a programming glitch.
Loveline. Can we talk here for a second?
Loveline. They are treading water in a sea of retarded sexuality.
Loveline. Exclusively on Tucson's New Rock. 92.1 KFMA.
It's Loveline. All right, well, that's about it. I want to thank the Kings guys for coming in here, Rob and Sean, for hanging out and having a good time. And until next time, this is Adam Carolla for the fabulous Dr. Drew saying mahalo.
Mommy!
This has been Loveline.
The views expressed on Loveline are not necessarily those of the staff, the management, or the sponsors of this radio station.
And are probably not the views of Westwood One Entertainment.
Loveline is produced by Ann Wilkins-Engel.
Now, please listen to this station longer.